Louise Elizabeth Nerding would rise to fame in the early 90s as one quarter of R&B girl group Eternal. But by 1995, and after just one album with the band, Louise would exit the group in favour of a more balanced lifestyle and her own solo music career. Having sold over 15 million records worldwide to date, this is the story of the fabulous Louise.
It's Eternal!
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 It is Eternal!
Eternal!
Baby.
Yeah, look at all those chicks.
Lou and I, we went to a nightclub, which my mum wasn't too pleased about that I was going to because I was 15 at the time. This guy comes over to Lou and he goes, can you sing? I was like, yeah. When he gives her a card and she comes over to us, she goes, this guy's in your mind. We were like, come on, Lou, he's probably some pervert, you know.
Maybe she thought I was trying to pick her up. Maybe I was just lying. But obviously intrigue did get to her because she called 3 months later.
I phoned one day from school in a lunch break.
She came down, met me. She was trying songs out, see what was feeling good.
She just couldn't believe her luck. And at the time, I didn't have anything to do with it. I can always remember going for a meeting where he introduced me to Esther and Vernet. We was all in the studio and there was talk that we really would be great if we had one more girl. I said, oh, I've got my friend from school, Kelly. I went down and I sang for him at the record company. And there it was, the four of us.
I'd love to know what Dennis's thinking was, because you had the sisters, came from like a gospel background, and Kelly and Louise, who, you know, stage school girls.
I wanted a twist, you know, pop and gospel together. It gave you a wider spread. So for me, you know, it's about the songs and the voices. No matter how
near or far. But I love their image with the boots and the tomboyish, and because Esther and Vernie are very religious, they didn't want to do anything that was sexual, which everyone thought would be a big mistake.
They were kind of forerunners of that kind of Britney Spears, I read my Bible every night. I think you want your pop stars to be wild.
Do you think your religious beliefs have kept you away from that raunchy image you could have gone for?
Yes, but then there are some people who are raunchy and still are Christians.
I like you to stay here.
Oh, blimey. Not now, little girl.
By the nature of the way that they got put together, I think the sisters always felt like, well, we're the group, and tried to make the other two feel a little bit. It's just the impression that I got that the other two were kind of like lucky.
We were on such a vibe and so happy to be given the opportunity just flying around the world promoting our record. It's so cliche, but it did happen overnight. Baby, can't you see? Sold 1.4 million albums in the first year, and we were a debut band. I didn't realise how great that was.
I think just to be here at the Brits and actually perform on the show for us was a great honour.
Eternal, the best new act.
Girls, are we enjoying ourselves?
Yeah. We'd won Best Newcomers at Smash Hits, and we'd been nominated for a Brit, and the album had gone like quadruple platinum. Looking back now, God, that was bloody fantastic, wasn't it? People were going, all these girls will last forever, they really are eternal, and that was, it was that kind of thing, and it was such a vibe.
What exactly has happened?
Well, I'm actually leaving Eternal, but Eternal are carrying on as a three-piece band. They've just gone off to America this morning, actually, to record Dallas Austin. So they're all remaining together, just me going.
And then
one day, I don't know where it came from, I just had to go.
And sometimes in a band, in a close situation, things happen. I suppose because you've got two sisters within the band, they might sort of gang up.
We do miss her really a lot.
The thing that destroyed Eternal was themselves.
We just were different people, and we just had different ideas on the way our lives were. It was really hard to understand one another.
Some people thought the white girls being kicked out of the group.
It
was horrible.
Race had nothing to do with Louise's departure at all.
I think the tabloids will make up what they want to make up. But a lot of it was to do with personality clashes.
It was just purely different people, different personalities that wanted different things.
It was the hardest decision I've ever made in my life. And it was building up over really a course of a year, and towards the latter part of the year was when, you know, I was just trying to build up the courage to tell someone, because I thought I was mad. I thought, you know, I'm mental. Why do I want to leave such a successful group?
It was thought strange at the time, but what about these rumours that Louise really left Eternal because the Americans can't accept a white girl in an R&B band?
Of course, some problems, you know, people couldn't understand it in the States. They were like, why, you know, it's not meant to be like this. But we would have faced that if I'd stayed in the band, and wasn't a reason for me leaving the band at all.
So what was it then? Are these rumours true that Esther and Vernie used to pick on Louise?
No, they didn't pick on me. I mean, we're different people, of course, you know, and we did all used to argue. You know, we were four girls for 4 years, travelling around the world out of suitcases, being tired, you know, working hard, and of course we used to argue. Yeah, I mean, they never used to pick on me or anything.
In the beginning, I felt like I was just going somewhere on my own and that I wasn't actually an artist. I was just going as Louise, part of Eternal, or ex-Eternal, as everyone called me. I think it was when the first single did well and I was at Top of the Pops, and I got home and I just sort of hit me. I thought, you know, I'd just been on Top of the Pops singing Light of My Life by Louise. Just that was the main first time I think it really hit home. One thing in life that I'm sure. Everybody was, I think, expecting me to come out with an up-tempo pop song. And I almost expected myself to come out with that. And I'd recorded Light of My Life with Simon Climie, which had a 32-piece orchestra on it. It was like a real big ballad. And I'd worked hard on the song, and everybody in my management and record company had said, oh, it's a lovely song. And my management said, we're going to go with that one first. And I was like, what, a ballad? And I can remember doing all the stations, you know, around the country, going, visiting them all, and I'd sort of say, oh, here's my new single, and they'd have a listen while you're actually in the room. It's the most nerve-wracking thing. I'd sort of just sit in the chair thinking, oh God, if they don't like it, what are they gonna say? People see you land up at me.
If only they could see what I see, then. Now known simply as Louise, her debut solo single was the orchestral ballad Light of My Life, released on the 25th of September 1995. The single would peak at number 8 on the UK singles chart.
Light of My Life, which was a very dreamy ballad. And I actually went and filmed the video in Hawaii with Black Sand. So when I got there, I was kind of like, where's the white sand? And they're like, no, we're doing it on black sand, which my little brother seemed to think was mud everywhere on my face. He was like, why are you doing a video in mud? It's like, that's very exotic, actually.
In What Love was, it was nice to get up there and start moving around, and sort of like, I had dancers on the road with me. It kind of brought back that group atmosphere that wasn't just me on stage, because with Light of My Life, 90% of the time would be me just there singing. And that can be quite daunting when you're in, at the time I was doing different road shows like Smash Hits and that, in front of 15, 20,000 people, and it's just me up on stage. Sort of think, oh no. But so the time I was doing In Walk Love, I'd have 4 or 5 dancers, and brought back that group atmosphere, which was, I looked forward to that. In walk love, in walk you.
Her second solo release, In Walked Love, previously a hit by the dance pop group Exposé, fared less well. Released on the 4th of March 1996, the song would miss the UK top 10, peaking at number 17. Despite this, Louise's third single, Naked, would see greater chart success, becoming her biggest hit to date. Released on the 27th of May, the track would enter the UK chart at number 5, being certified platinum.
I lie awake, hesitate between love and hate. I know you've been feeding my
Louise's debut solo album, also entitled Naked, was subsequently released a month later on the 24th of June. The album peaked at number 7 in the UK album charts. It was later certified platinum for selling over 300,000 copies.
For me was that step forward. It was about transforming myself from Louise ex Eternal into Louise an artist, because I never expected to ever lose the tag totally, but I thought, you know, it's about time I did started losing it now and again. So Naked for me was, I think, the song that did turn me around to being able to go to, you know, America and do the video I did over there and work with the likes of Jamie King, who worked with the likes of Madonna and Janet Jackson. So, you know, that gave me the opportunity just to try and make the whole show a little bit bigger. A lot of hours were spent on dancing for the Naked video. I'd gone over to LA and I knew that this guy that was going to choreograph the single was really good, and he had done this first and that first, but I didn't have a clue what to expect. I went into the studio early the beginning of the week and I saw the routine and all the dancers kind of that were going to be in the video knew it. And they said, okay, we just got to teach it to you now. And I was like, I'm leaving, I'm not getting up there. And these dancers were fantastic, they were so talented. And we worked really about 5 days non-stop on that routine, getting it as tight could be. I had a nightmare doing the video for Undivided Love because they kept asking me to stay underwater and I just kept floating to the top. So in the end, my choreographer Jamie, who was in the video also, He had to swim to the bottom of the pool and try and hold my feet down so they could just get a shot of me somewhere under the water. Just like holding my ankles, kicking, so I thought, oh, I've got to breathe. But it was a nightmare. It was enjoyable because when they said about, you know, water and maybe swimming in the video, I didn't want it to be a case of bikini on, let's go swimming around a swimming pool. So I quite liked the concept of the pool was inside and I was actually in shoes, trousers and a shirt underneath this pool, which had a slightly different concept of it rather than me swimming around in a swimming costume, which I wasn't too keen on doing.
Two further singles were released from the album. Undivided Love on the 19th of August, again securing Louise another UK number 5 chart placing. And One Kiss from Heaven, released on the 18th of November, which would peak at number 9. Heaven, kiss, baby, one touch, I'm going crazy.
One Kiss from Heaven, even though it was my last single, it was one of my favourite singles, so I was actually really looking forward to doing that song. Normally videos are quite really long days and just kind of, you know, most of the work's based on you trying to perform and kind of give it all you've got all day or all 2 days, whatever. But One Kiss from Heaven just had all them professional people around me, Michelle Gale and Kelly and everyone who just sort of could help you along. And it was a great day. It was basically us all in a gorgeous house, just chilling.
Picture this. Louise, make it. Five smash hits on one exceptional album. Get naked with Louise now.
For me is the main focus, and I don't know where the urge comes from, but I just think you have to utilize what talent you're given. And you have the Aretha Franklins of this world that have the most spectacular voice, and you don't need to see anything else, you don't need to hear anything else apart from that. And then you get the Michael Jacksons and the Madonnas that have got a great voice, but they have a strong talent in other areas, which is enjoyment, I think. It's not a talent, anything other than total enjoyment to perform and move. And for me, that's, I don't know, I suppose I just enjoy to bring things to life. Not a real kind of conscious effort of, right, I'm going to go out there and really try to perform. It's kind of like, you know, the music comes on, you start singing, and it's a natural enjoyment process for me. It's not really a tried thing.
My name's Caroline Rice. This is Jamie King, the choreographer. And another assistant, Luca Tomasini. And as you know, you're here today to audition for the 97 tour for Louise. Very exciting.
When you announced this tour, I'm trying to think, it was actually back in the Capitol Cafe,
yeah,
about 4 or 5 months ago.
Uh-huh.
And you came up with the idea there, and you're saying, right, I'm going to find dancers from out on the street almost. So why did you come up, just again, why did you come up with that idea?
It was just a case of, I don't know, I think everybody deserves sometimes a chance in life, and you get loads of talented people out there that never get a chance or an opportunity to go and do what they've always wanted to do. So I just thought, if I can maybe just open, even if it's only 2 doors, then it's kind of just putting a little bit of something back into all the help everyone's given me. This is Jamie.
Hello.
He's the man.
The man, the girl.
And this is Caroline, and this is the crew that are here today.
Hey.
This is the crew that's here today, and they're kind of going for all the auditions. I'm basically leaving it to them because they're the professionals. I'm just sitting back and watching. So, and I'm really grateful that you'll come over to take part in
it. Yeah, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
Is this just going to be a lot bigger than anything you've done before? Are you really sort of pulling out all the stops for this one?
I'm doing my best. I mean, obviously, there's only so far you can go. I've only had one album out, and you know, it's only the first kind of touring I'm going to be doing. Hopefully, there's going to be lots more to follow. But I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to make it as spectacular as I possibly can. In walks love, in walks you, in walks all my dreams coming true. Walks love, run through my door.
I've always loved dancing. I mean, some of my favourite dancers, I used to watch Janet videos, everything. I just picked out these specific dancers.
I'm looking forward to every one of my dancers watching him dance, because I know as a dancer they're trained. When I went over to work with him in Naked, It made me realise how ungood a dancer I was.
He's amazing. He's everything I've ever looked for in a choreographer and a director for what I want to do and where I want to be in life. So he's fantastic for the world. The last the audition I went to that was as big as this was when I was about 10 and I went for Annie in Bromley.
And did you get it?
No.
So you can imagine how the people out there are feeling.
I respect them so much because that put me off auditions for life.
That's right. All right.
Thanks very much.
Do I look
okay for
big
breakfast? For me, the people you work with and the people that surround you, and you know, everybody from the people that kind of do your everyday schedule to people you work with in the studio, everybody has to give a big part of themselves to you to almost kind of further your career, you know. I mean, I know when you work with producers, if the song's a hit, it furthers their career and, you know, they get a better name for themselves. But the ultimate person that is furthering their career is you. And I respect somebody that would take that much time out on me to kind of make what I want to happen. So therefore, you know, I think a mutual respect is so important. And also just feeling comfortable and confident with the people you're working with. Let me introduce you to Roger. This is so important. Roger is the tour manager. Now this man here is the one that puts it all together, the venues, the budget. He sorts out for these guys to come over. He's the main man. He's the one that we are for coming on tour. And let me not forget two other people.
Very important.
Okay, these are also important. This is Graham, who's he's my promoter. So he's the one that makes, you know, this extremely possible by going to all the venues. And Miss Baldock, management, mother. And that's just me, mate.
I don't think we never. That word is hard, but.
So it's due to this whole lot of people that makes everything really possible. It's not down to me at all. I just go out there and sing at the end of the day. This is the girl. These girls are the most important fans.
We're gonna make it.
Now, can I ask you a couple of questions about your single?
Sure.
While we're here. Can you tell me the sentiment behind the single?
It's kind of got an Eastern feel, kind of a worldly feel. We use lots of different instruments, like in the single, to try and create that all over the world.
Some days I get up and I'm totally kind of all over the place and trying to get it all into perspective. But the most important thing is, I think, to be professional at all times when you're doing that job. Because, I don't know, I think people respect professionalism. You know, whether they like your music, whether they hate your music, whether they think you're a crap singer or a brilliant singer, if you're professional about the job you're doing, people can still, they still have to respect you for that. Because if you're up there and they don't like the way you're singing and you're acting like a complete, I don't know what, then, you know, they have a right to go and badmouth you. But I know people might say, oh, I love her music or I don't love her music, but she knows how to get the job done and she does it correctly. And that's important, I think, because word about mouth in the music industry is also, unfortunately, which is really, I think, really sad, it plays a big part in people's careers. You know, the way people think of you as a person, also as much as what the way people think of your music.
No, I'm all right.
Today was an unusually late start for a video. I didn't get here to 11 because I had to go for an eye contact fitting early this morning, so I got here about 11. And the day's just really gone on. I've only done one look as well, and in this video there's going to be like 5, so still lots ahead.
Hey, concept behind the video is kind of a weird one. It's about me, Louise, the real Louise. It's like just me being shocked at how many clones there are of me around the world. So it's kind of like, it's just strange, one of them futuristic weird ones.
Happy?
Yeah, lovely. Do I sing when I think of you into that?
Yeah, please.
Okay, thank you. Watch me get it wrong now. I've got different favourite videos for kind of different reasons. Naked for me was one of the favourites because of the choreography and the dancing, and it was just, it was hard work but really good fun to do because I like dancing, and to incorporate that much dancing in one video was the first for me. And One Kiss from Heaven because I had all my mates in it, and it was the easiest video I've ever done. The second album, I felt slightly more confident than I did on the first album. You know, I actually felt like if I didn't like something on the first album, I'd be worried that maybe it was just my taste was not quite, you know, what it should be, and I should maybe listen to it and get to like it. Where on this album, if I knew if I didn't like something, I didn't like something. If I loved something, I loved something. And I kind of almost trusted my own judgment more. Some videos you kind of leave in the evening and you know what it's going to look like. Like there's been some like One Kiss from Heaven, that was kind of, I knew pretty much the vibe of it, we could see it all on the screen. And then like today, the video I'm doing today, because there's so much done after with the effects of the different people and everything, it's going to completely be a different video by the time I leave here and see it. So that's when it gets nerve-wracking, when you're not quite sure what you're going to see. At one stage I didn't know if I could ever write songs that really meant a lot to me, because I never had, and on the first album I'd wrote songs but there wasn't real personal songs. On this album, I don't know if maybe I've been for a little bit more, experienced a little bit more in life, but I felt like I wanted to actually, you know, well naturally I just, when I would begin to write a song, I'd sort of naturally begin to write about a feeling I had or a feelings I'd felt. So on this album there are a couple of quite personal songs, which is quite nice. When I listen to the album and then them songs come on, I kind of, you know, get that up the back, my back, and I think, oh God, these songs like actually mean a lot to me. When will my heart beat again? Special side of Louise. I know there's a special side. I think it's really important to not give all in your music, and to give all as an artist and as a singer. But I think if you give too much away as a person, you know, about your private life, it's not that you're trying to be edgy or you're trying to be kind of stuck up or anything. It's just for your own sanity. I think it's just good to have a slight bit of privacy, and just to know that something in your life is just yours and nobody else's. Yeah. Okay.
That's
a simple bit that really just simple warm up. I always think a new feel is created, you know. A lot of people kind of say, right, you've got a new album, you've got to have a new image, you've got to have a new this, a new that. And for me, I just think a new feel always just comes along because times change. And it was 6-7 months ago that I last had a single out and last even had a video on the TV. And a lot changes, you know, fashion-wise, the kind of new videos that are being brought out constantly. And you change as a person. Where will my heart beat again? And I'm walking too fast.
You might get the Reebok campaign.
Do you reckon I get a train this campaign?
Also, I enjoy when I make a video, people are like, you know, is this a new sexy image or is this a new sporty image? It's kind of, no, this is like one page in a book that you take yourself out of being Louise, you know, and you just change visually what you look like. It doesn't mean you actually change as a person or your own morals or your own values. You dress up almost for a video. Pros and cons. There's a lot of pros. One, I'm doing a job that I've always wanted to do, and the opportunity came along, and you know, I've taken it. And it's just, oh God, to earn a living for this is fantastic. The pros outweigh the cons, but for me, I mean, the cons for everyone are different. For me, the cons, I think I get homesick when I travel for too long. I miss home, I miss my mum and dad and my friends and everybody around me. The Woman in Me. I'd actually recorded a single on the album called The Woman in Me. It's a great song. I really like the song, and I thought it just said quite a lot. It's like when I did Light of My Life and the Naked album, a lot of people were like, oh, Louise is, you know, she's getting raunchy, is she getting this, you know, has she had this done, has she had that done? And it kind of upset me because I was a bit like, hang on a minute, when you guys all saw me on my first album, I made the album when I was 18 17, and now I'm 21, and you know, and I'm just getting older, and that's all it's about. It's not me trying to create and be a big girl. It's like, I am growing up. I am sorting my life out on a personal level and music level. And The Woman in Me, I think, just kind of said that. It's like, okay, you know, you've all seen young Louise, and I'm going to turn into a woman one day. And, you know, this is the beginning of it.
In 1997, Louise would return to music with the lead single off her next album. Arms Around the World was released on the 22nd of September, entering the top 5, peaking at number 4. Her second solo album, Woman in Me, would follow on the 6th of October and debut at number 5 in the UK and go multi-platinum. The album also made an impact across Europe, charting well in a number of countries. To support and celebrate the success of the album, Louise embarked on a UK-wide sell-out arena tour of over 20 dates, including Wembley Arena. On the 17th of November, Let's Go Round Again, a cover of a song by The Average White Band, was the second single released from the album. The track would enter the UK Top 10 at number 10.
Today I'm making a new video for All That Matters, so I've been here since about 8 o'clock this morning, which isn't too bad for a video shoot, so they come and get made up and all that kind of stuff. I'd say it's normally about a 16 to a 20 hour day. It'd be really nice to just come in and put a bit of lip gloss on and go, you know. The video is set in somewhere like Arizona, and it's like a trailer park. It's based around a kind of like a circus, but not a normal circus, like people that can do extremely weird things. I wanted just to do a video that was slightly more laid back, slightly more reserved, something that, you know, would work well with a song, something that wasn't so dressy, like, you know, I could be more casual, be a bit more me, really. In the tears of so many years, when I think of the time we spent, and I can't seem to stop the tears from falling. At the moment they're filming in double speed, so I also have to sing double time. Well, it's actually a double time and a bit, because what they want to do through half of the shoot is kind of then in back when they go to the editing suite, they slow it down. It hurts more than you can know. First of all, you've got, say, a director and a producer. This is the director, this is Trudy. She's actually also my video commissioner. Then you have kind of assistant producers and assistant directors.
My name's Barry and I'm the first assistant director. And that's like being the sergeant major in an army. Only the army is the film unit. And so how our sergeant majors go around going, do this, do that, get that there, move that. And that's what I do.
He's the guy who's the big mouth.
Director will say, move that chair. And then you very loudly go, okay, why is that chair there? Move it. So it's like that. So it's like we're really expensively paid parrots sometimes.
We keep populating.
Do I love it? It's the best job in the world.
There's so much to do if you want to get into video or film. You know, there's so many jobs, sound, there's just so many things that, you know, young people can look into doing.
On the grip, wherever they want the camera, you get the camera.
Well, I'm a camera assistant, I'm focus puller.
I'm here providing some animals for the pop promo, and I've got a load of snakes in my van.
My job title today is the leading man.
On the 22nd of March 1998, All That Matters would become the third and final single to be lifted off the record. The single was less successful, peaking at number 11.
More than anything I need.
Album. I love this. It's called Elbow Beach because that's where you spent your honeymoon.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Where is it?
It's in Bermuda.
Wonderful. Right. Yeah, gorgeous and romantic.
Just next to Echo Beach.
Oh, yeah, right. No, yeah, I wanted to name the album something pretty personal as I co-wrote it, and, you know, it means a lot to me, this album, so it kind of all ties in.
In 1998, Louise married her longtime boyfriend, footballer Jamie Redknapp. She then spent just under a year making what she claimed was her most personal album to date. Creatively, Louise was more involved in the process of this album than her previous two, co-writing 9 of the 12 tracks.
Doing my brand new video for my new single, Two Faces.
Who does she think she is? Jack
and the Real.
Hi, girls.
The song is about two-faced people, very fickle, very superficial. And the video's along those lines. I go to a party that's very high society. Everybody's extremely done up, but they're all there because they're so-called in people and not because they are, you know, genuine friends or anything. A lot of this video is going to be done in post-production, and these big green boards here are going to be other people that they're shooting tomorrow. And on our TV screen, hopefully, they're going to actually become pieces of paper in the sense that they're horrible people that we don't want to be associated with because they're not real and they're unfriendly. So at the moment, it's a bit bland.
Roll tape and play back.
Problem. My shoes, my heel was about that thin and about that long, so we're doing our best though, and my choreographer keeps telling me off, shouting, saying, put some trainers on. I'm like, no, I want to wear the boots. I think we're going to do a bit of a routine now in these heels. So this could be the last time you will ever see me again, who knows.
Okay, first position please.
My last single was out a good 2 years ago. I never had any intentions of giving it up. I just felt that I'd worked very hard from the age of 16 in Eternal. And I think sometimes you can get carried away with the whole, you know, we must keep going, because if you stop, you know, there's new acts and they come and take your place. And I think after a while, your fans aren't silly. They know when you need time to sort of go away from it and really enjoy. I got married, which took up a little bit of time, so it's nice to have a little bit of time indoors. Then I've been making an album. I wanted to make sure that I was 100% involved in everything, and that takes a lot of time to get it just right and how I wanted it.
Hi, I'm Louise. Welcome to my box talk and my little weekend home. But anyway, you can check out my new video, Two Face. Twisted and deceitful, all those two-faced people, taking me for some kind of fool. Pretending to... Okay, the reason behind the single basically comes from, I think, everybody, no matter what you do, gets some kind of negativity from other people. And I actually wrote the song after one day I was walking down the street and somebody crossed from one side of the street onto my side of the street just to tell me that, you know, they wasn't into me and I looked bad. And it really kind of got to me, and I went home and thought about it and just thought, just fell down a hole, did you see that? Writing an album, I did co-write with two other girls, and we spent 9 months together, just the three of us. I actually recorded all of the album in one place, and it was in Doncaster. No glamour for me, no LA.
The lead single from Elbow Beach, the R&B-tinged Two-Faced, was released on the 17th of July 2000. It would enter the UK charts at number 3, becoming Louise's highest charting solo single. Despite initial hype and critical praise, total sales for Elbow Beach were weaker than her previous two records, and the album would miss the top 10, peaking at number 12. The 30th of October saw the release of the final single, Beautiful Inside. The track was noted for containing a sample from the song Different Strokes by Syl Johnson, also used by the Wu-Tang Clan. The song charted at number 13 on the UK singles chart. A third single, For Your Eyes Only, had been selected and remixed, but the single was dropped due to the low charting of Beautiful Inside. The single mix sampled Chic's Le Freak and appeared on Louise's MySpace profile at the time.
Idea that was put to me, someone said, oh, you should really do a cover of Stuck in the Middle. I thought, well, it was an old classic, you can't touch songs like that. And they said, well, just give it a go, if you don't like it, you know, you can go in the bin. So I sung it, and about a month later, actually, I got it back on a CD full of all other songs that I'd been recording that particular kind of few weeks. And when it came on, I just thought, you know, I quite like this. It was really catchy, and it just had something about it. I thought, you know, it's different from anything I've done before, and I could have such good fun with the video, doing a complete spoof rip-off of Reservoir Dogs. I signed a 5-album deal with them when I was 16, and for the 5th album, they felt it would be nice to go with the greatest hits. And I've released 17 records, which makes up a perfect amount for an album. And I think they felt that it would be kind of like a nice end of chapter, and there was enough records there to do it, so it was a natural sort of progression to do. When I heard them come out with Power of a Woman, and I can remember sort of sitting in the car and hearing them on the radio, I can remember just thinking, what have I done? Just what have I done? Am I mad or what? But looking back, I think I made the right decision, just on a personal level.
After the release of Elbow Beach, Louise still owed the label one more album as part of her 5-album deal with EMI, including Eternals, Always and Forever. So, in 2001, the label decided to release a Greatest Hits compilation, incorporating all of her top 10 hit singles, including those she had performed with Eternal. Called Changing Faces, The Best of Louise, the collection featured 3 new tracks, including a cover of 5 Star's 1987 hit, The Slightest Touch. The lead single for the Greatest Hits was a cover of Stuck in the Middle with You by Steeler's Wheel. Released on the 27th of August 2001, the single reached number 4 on the UK singles chart. Here I am,
stuck in the middle with you. Yes, I'm stuck in the middle with you. And I'm wondering what it is I should do. It's so hard to keep this smile from my face. Losing control, yeah, I'm all over the place. Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Well, you started out with nothing, and you found that you're a self-made man. Yeah. And your friends, they all come crawling, slap you on the back and say, please, please.
The album itself peaked at number 9 in the UK, and Louise embarked on the second solo tour of her career.
Trying to make some sense of it all, but I can see that it makes no sense at all. Is it cool to go to sleep on the floor? I don't think that I can take it anymore. Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you.
For me, the greatest hits is basically a little bit of an end of an era. You know, it's a change of record company. It's a change of direction musically as well for me. You know, a bit of a new step. I'm getting older now. You know, you have to keep on moving forward. I think fresh input is extremely important in the music industry. So it's a new beginning.
Excellent.
Yay. Yes.
Fantastic. Now, I know the album was called Changing Faces.
Yes.
I wondered why that was. And I know the tour is also called Changing Faces.
Yeah. It's just basically, I mean, I've got a few more wrinkles from the early days. The face is changing.
No,
the face is definitely changing. No, and it's just really represents, you know, over the years, from the early Eternal days, you know, we do change and we grow up. And it was just a name, really, that represented each year, slightly different album cover.
Oh, there's loads I want to do. I'd like to go on and make an album that's great. I'd like it to, you know, be slightly different. I think I've grown up a lot. I'd like to go out and do a great live tour with a great band. You know, maybe some different kind of gigs. You still feel like you have to prove yourself all the time in this industry, and I feel that I've still got a lot of proving myself left to do. So I'd like to go out and achieve that.
We are controlling transmission.
He broke my heart into a million pieces. He lied to me, and so I turned away.
In 2002, Louise signed a £1.5 million contract with Positive Records, a division of Universal Music, to record her fourth solo album. The album was due for release in 2004, alongside the single Bounce Back, a song previously recorded by Stacey Orrico and which featured on her 2003 self-titled album. However, due to Louise falling pregnant with her first child, the song and album were never released.
Pandora's Kiss is a song that when I first heard it, I just fell in love with it because I liked the rockiness of it and the way it was still a pop record. But it just was a little bit heavier. And lyrically, it's quite kind of quirky. You know, it's basically a love story, but you have to really listen to decipher it. And she's basically saying, you know, I can have you if I want.
And you can't get into your next position because you move your head, so it's the hair.
The story from the video is taken from the record's called Pandora's Kiss, so it kind of what it really is about is Pandora's box. You know, so it's set in all different boxes, and as you can see from the hair and makeup and the clothes and the lighting, it's all a little bit darker than I think I've ever been shot before. And this is all like, I don't know, my madhouse where I fling myself up against the walls. And there's somebody in the outside world kicking the box around.
Because he's kicking you, so you're just like, I
Which gets me lots of movement, and I've got like an electro room and a rock room, and you know, there's loads of stuff going on. It's just a good vibe video, really.
The only material to be released from those recording sessions was the double A-side, Pandora's Kiss, Don't Give Up, issued on the 15th of September 2003, and which peaked at number 5 and raised money for Tickled Pink Breast Cancer Care. Tracks from Louise's unreleased fourth album would eventually leak online some years later. Over the course of the following years, Louise would take a back step from music to focus on her marriage, family life, raising children, and venturing into TV presenting, acting, advertising, and fashion. It would be an appearance on the BBC show Strictly Come Dancing in 2016 that would reignite Louise's passion for performing, but that would also be the catalyst for the breakdown of her marriage to Jamie Redknapp.
My memory is that doing Strictly was absolutely seminal to you. It kind of made you feel that you... It made you feel, to use that awful phrase which everyone does now, it made you feel very empowered. It made you feel that you could do something other than being a wife and mum, which I know you very much enjoyed, but you could do something else. And that it was for you, it was a kind of a moment of, you know, I can be someone else while you were doing that.
I think it reminded me of, and this was no one else's fault, and definitely not Jamie's, you know, things that go on in a marriage are far deeper than a TV programme. You know, people can put a programme on something. You know, there's different emotions and feelings that go on for years. I think what the programme really did for me, it just reminded me of how much I love performing and music and singing and actually...
And dancing, and you were brilliant on dancing.
And my kids actually, it's kind of, they see that now. They come to their gigs and they go, you know what, Mum, it's been a really tough time for everybody, but it's so great to hear you singing along in the car, the music you've made, and watching you, whether it be in the West End or, you know, a music video or, you know, just at a gig.
But you know what I think is interesting? You don't have to be Louise Redknapp in this.
No.
Which is good.
No.
You can put on a wig, you can put on those costumes and whatever, and you're not being judged as you are Sally Bowles.
Yeah, and that's what has been such... It's something really new for me. I've never done musical theatre before, and to go into a role like Sally Bowles, she's such an amazing character. I mean, she's a dark character, she's very vulnerable, she's slightly crazy, and it was directed by Rufus Norris, who is an incredible director. So the whole feeling of the show is something, if someone had said to me a year ago you'd go up on stage every night dressed like that singing Mine Hair or singing Life is a Cabaret, and actually it's really emotional, like her role within the whole show is quite emotional. She's on a real roller coaster.
Well, I was just thinking, we were talking earlier and you were talking about your nerves, the terror of Strictly, how you sat in your dressing room thinking I don't think I can do this.
Yes.
And this is your first West End musical.
Yeah.
So what made you take that leap and go, no, I can do this?
Do you know, I think going through the sort of process of Strictly, every week you're put out there and you feel terrified, don't you? It's no, you can't explain how terrified you feel, because not only are you putting yourself out there to be judged, but you're hoping the audience don't send you home and that they like what you do. And if you go home, that's also going to be a bit of a slap in the face, like, ah. And I think that experience just made me really realise how much I love being on stage, and actually just sometimes in life you have to be fearless.
Following her successful stint in Cabaret, Louise would join the cast of 9 to 5 the Musical in 2019.
Others may glow from the stardust I throw in their path, never thinking I'd shine. Like some Hollywood queen, I've arrived on the scene, a sensation, the toast of the town. I'm wallowing in it, I love every minute, so I may never come down.
In September 2017, Louise revealed she would be returning to the music industry by announcing her first live show in more than 15 years at Under the Bridge in London on the 22nd of December. Titled Intimate and Live, tickets for the show would sell out in under 5 minutes. In early 2018, Warner Chappell UK confirmed Louise had signed a deal with them to release new music. Louise posted a picture on her Instagram account, revealing she had been back in the recording studio. On the 25th of March 2019, Louise announced that her fourth studio album, Heavy Love, would be released in October 2019. Of the album's 15 tracks, Louise would co-write all but 3 songs. The lead single, Stretch, was released on the 26th of March 2019 to critical acclaim. If you get your words right, if you act the way I hope you do, there's no need to be shy. I'll bend any way you want me to. You're so close but not quite. Can you stretch another inch or two?
Yeah, 16 years since the last record, which I can't believe it. When I first read that, I was like, there's definitely been a typo. There's no way. But no, it really has been 16 years.
It's crazy. I can't even begin to comprehend how that feels, because I know you've played live since, like, in the last couple of years. You've played festivals and tours.
Yeah, it really feels like I've not been away that long, though. It's strange. I feel like it's just, you know, it was just yesterday that I had sort of Naked Out and Pandora's Kiss and all those songs. So, it's just good to be back.
So the new album is called Heavy Love.
Yes.
And I know that you recorded it in Sweden, you recorded it in LA and London as well.
Yes, yeah.
I think the Sweden element of that is perfect, because it sounds like quite a poignant album. Was it quite difficult in some respects to record? Because I know you've had quite a difficult couple of years.
Yeah, I think the album definitely, I wrote and recorded it over the sort of last year and a half. And I think sitting back and listening to all the music that we made, I can definitely see sort of this life journey that's kind of just kind of gone along. It was really important for me that I kept the album really positive. As much as there's some really personal songs on there, but I think in a sense that maybe different from what people will expect. And there's also some really good funky disco.
Amazing.
Kind of back to the funky disco tracks, and then there's the more what I would say current sound of Stretch and Small Talk and a few things like that. So there's definitely a bit of everything on there.
I think Sweden's a really interesting part of that as well, because so much of music that comes from Sweden, and the place itself, is very atmospheric.
Yeah.
And I think it's such a great sound. A lot of the producers from Sweden produce something that's quite dramatic.
Yeah, I mean, Stretch was definitely different, and I think definitely not what people were maybe expecting to come out. I like to think that this album can hit lots of different age brackets and lots of different types of people. I always say Stay stands the test of time no matter what. It always sounds like a great record. And I wanted to have a couple of songs on the album that did that.
Do you feel quite different as an artist since the early 90s? Because it was, what, 1992 when Eternal began?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I remember writing sort of as a 22-year-old, and as much as everyone's different, there's some songwriters that are just absolutely amazing songwriters and can write at any age. I think I write from such a personal place
that
I think to write this album was definitely easier than in the past when I've written. It sort of just all flowed, just all come out. So, yeah, it was great. I suppose I've had a lot more life experiences being a mum and everything else that Absolutely. Happens in life.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned Stretch. That's the current single.
Yes.
Great video for that as well.
Yeah.
And the next single is going to be with Clean Bandit. Of course, I've had such a phenomenal few years.
Yeah, yeah, it's written by Clean Bandit. Yeah, it's just a big summer song. I mean, it's purely got to be played when the sun's out. It makes me smile, you know. It's really different from Stretch, but it puts a smile on your face and you just want to wind the windows down in the car and feel the warmth, you know. Let's hope we have a good summer, otherwise I'm screwed.
Well, we're counting on you, Louise.
We need a good summer. And
I can help it. Ooh, I want to know what makes you feel like you're allowed to treat me so unkindly. Is it just to show why are you hiding all of your true feelings? Why'd you leave me?
Heavy Love would eventually be pushed back to a release date of the 17th of January 2020, with Louise citing the promotional schedule for 9 to 5 the Musical as the reason for the delayed release. The album would peak in the UK album chart at number 11 and at number 2 in the UK independent album chart.
So Stretch, I think, was really the first song that I had a real clear sense of direction for the album. I recorded it in Sweden. It was sexy. It kind of had no boundaries. I knew I could make a great video to it. And I think that was the first song that I sort of had a clear run and view of what Heavy Love should be and the direction it should be in. And it was always a great first single choice in my mind. And I'm so pleased that we sort of opened up Heavy Love with that record.
Why'd you leave me on? 'Cause I don't know what you're hiding from.
Leave Me On is such a big summery track. When I first heard Leave Me On, I just thought, I want to get in the car, put the windows down and drink sangria. It was written by Jack from Clean Bandit, and I think you can instantly tell because it's got that Clean Bandit kind of feel to it. And it's just a great summer song. I think you have to smile and it makes you want to go on holiday, Leave Me On. Breaking Back Together is a song that it's quite a personal song for me. It's about breaking us back together, breaking yourself as a person. I was having a tough time and every day my mum would give me a few words of advice. And on this particular day, I went into the studio and just wrote them all down. So it's a pretty personal song and one I'm really proud of.
When you kiss me now,
Not the Same is the big Throw Your Hands in the Air song. I worked with Sky and Danny on this song and it's a really upbeat song, but when you listen to the lyrics, it's actually quite sad and quite meaningful. We've got a gospel choir on it, which gives it that real kind of old school, a slightly eternal feel for me. I think this is one of those songs that is so great live because everybody joins in and everyone kind of sings the chorus. You've got to throw your hands in the air with this one.
But now it's just small talk.
Small Talk is a song that I think lyrically kind of just speaks the truth. It's about
maybe being in a situation where you know someone so well, yet all you have is small talk now. Anybody that's had a breakup and you've known someone so well and then you just see them or bump into them and you make kind of idle small talk, that's what the song's about. I love this song, I love singing it. I think it's a song that most people in this world will be able to empathise with in some way or another.
I know it's gonna hurt, but I'd rather be a fool than let my heart hate me for not
hurt. Hurt for me is all about the opening line, head back, feet on the dashboard. I love that lyric. It's about loving someone and knowing that you shouldn't love them because you're most probably gonna get hurt, but you're gonna go with it anyway. This song is a slight departure from the rest of the album. I think it's got a slightly different sound and feeling. It's kind of a little bit of a standalone record. I'm really pleased that it's a song that I think has made quite a lot of impact. Hammer is one of my favourite songs on the album. This is everything I grew up listening to and what I love to listen to personally. I can't wait to sing this live. This is all about going on tour. It's funky, it's cool. I love singing it. Definitely can't wait to get this one on tour.
I just need a minute.
Just a Minute is quite a personal song again, and it's basically saying just give me a minute before I'm able to say goodbye, because that doesn't happen overnight. It's got a really good feeling behind it, it's got a strong chorus, and it kind of does what it says. It's just give me a minute to say goodbye.
You used to call me Wonder Woman.
Wonder Woman was written by the amazing JoJo, who I'm a really big fan of. This is definitely my nod to 90s R&B. This is the kind of music I grew up to. It's slow, it's sexy, it's a really cool ballad. I love singing it. So yeah, super excited for everyone to hear Wonder Woman. Hands on the Sink was written with the very talented Ray, and it's really hard to explain what Hands on the Sink is about. It's got a lot of power, a lot of intent behind it. I love singing it. I have to say, I think it's one of my favourite vocals I recorded on the album, and I think that's because you immerse yourself so much in the story of the lyric. I'm really looking forward to people hearing this, because I think it's a maybe step in a different direction for me. I Won't Give You Up was written with the lovely Sinead Harnett. The lyrics basically about, I won't give you up, but I might have to because this is going nowhere. I love the emptiness to the track. I love what the whole song's about. It's got an upbeat sound. It's quite stripped back. It's got quite a raw feeling to it. And I think it sits so well on the album. Straight to My Heart is the summer banger. This song needs sunshine without a shadow of a doubt. I often forget about listening to Straight to My Heart because we sort of focus in on some of the other songs, and then when it comes on, I end up smiling from ear to ear. It was a really fun song to record. It was one of those songs that we were in the studio just having the best time. It's got such a lovely, great summery vibe. The lyrics really positive. It's all about falling in love. Yeah, roll on the summer. Villain is one of my special songs on the album. It's a very honest song from me and something that I really feel that I went through and the way I felt for a small period of my life. It's a song I'm super proud of, and it's kind of got that old school Janet Jackson vibe to it. And anyone that knows me knows I love Janet Jackson, so it's my nod definitely to her. So I can't wait to go and perform this song. And yeah, it's got quite a special little place in my heart, this song.
Ain't gonna settle for nothing unless he blows my mind.
Settle for Nothing is another one of those songs that I think we all need to have on our phone ready to play when we're having a bad day. It's about
not scratching the surface of someone or something that isn't giving you anything, but actually going in for everything you believe you deserve. I listen to Settle for Nothing when I'm having a bad day or if I'm questioning myself about anything, and it kind of perks me up, and I really hope other people get the same sense from this song. This is about making you all feel amazing. I love this song. Again, I'm so looking forward to getting this song out on tour, and I think it will be a personal fave of lots of the fans that have been with me from start to finish.
Don't let nobody treat you too bad. You realize how bad.
Wrong, I suppose it's the song I'm most nervous about people listening to. This is a real personal experience from my heart. This isn't about other things, other people, just about my heart. And it really is the first time I think I've put my heart on my sleeve in such a big way publicly ever. It's a hard song to sing. It's a song that I'm really, really proud of. A very sad song, but I'm very proud of it.
Turn back the hands of time. Let's go round again. One more time.
Following the success of the Heavy Love album campaign, Louise continues to record new material, perform live, as well as her work on stage in theatre productions. The future looks very bright for Louise indeed. Thanks for watching.
You brought in a brand new morning sun.
Believe it, honey.